thank you, God, this morning. With you, with your eyes closed right there where you are, just say thank you, Jesus, for coming. You coming into this world, God, affected my life and changed everything. Nothing can be compared with you in my life, in my heart. And I just want to let you know, God, that you are way, way, way bigger, way, way more important than anything else in my life. And we celebrate Christmas because we celebrate you. And we pray in your name, Jesus. Amen, and amen, and amen. Amen. You may be seated. It's so good to be here today. I am so glad to be here. And thank you for coming and for being part of the church in all these services that we are doing, and the people that is coming is just really, really, really. I was asking myself, thinking about what to preach, I was thinking, what am I going to talk about? And I can tell you, something came to my mind, especially this year, of so many things who are different. But this whole thing that is going on with COVID and everything has not affected my life as Christmas, as Jesus affected my life. Amen. I tell you, this COVID has affected us, but if we divide in 1,000 pieces or in 1,000,000 pieces what Jesus has done for me and how he affected my life, it's not to compare with how small COVID has affected my life. And this whole thing is going to be over. And we're going to have a normal life again. And Jesus is going to keep changing our lives. For the kids, we want you just to, I promise we're not going to stay too long here. But you got one of these papers here. And we want the kids to stay. And they are behaving so good. And you want to follow the message on this side here. And you want to fill up all this left side with all the empty places. But I want you to open your Bibles today in the book of Matthew. And I want you to go with me about the story of Christmas. And we're going to see some important and powerful thing in this scripture. Matthew, the title of the message is, Why is Christmas So Big? Matthew 1, 18 to 23, it says, this is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. But before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace. He had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. Let's pray. Father, we thank you because Christmas is about God coming into this world to die for our sins, to change and transform our lives. I ask you, God, that you would just help us. Just help us to put you first in every area of our lives, including this Christmas. And we thank you for what you're doing in the midst of everything. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, and amen, and amen. Christmas is pretty huge in my home. It was always big, and it will always be big. And the reason is because we want our kids and our family and the people that is around us to understand that this is the biggest thing ever. Why? Because Jesus came into this world to change our lives. We plan and we shop and we save money and we buy gifts, and it seems like it's never ending. I wanted to go camping tomorrow and Tuesday, and we wanted to be going camping for a long time. And Katie says, there's no way we go camping before Christmas. I said, but we just have to go to a grocery store. We're done with the gifts and all that. There's no way. I have to do all these things still before Christmas. And it's a huge deal. The prophecy of Jesus, the Messiah, coming before he was born happened by the prophet Isaiah 740 years before. So they were waiting, the Jewish people were waiting for the Messiah to come and fix everything for 740 years. Now we know this COVID is going to be done probably in a year, in 6 months, in 2 months. We don't know. Probably you can read all kinds of stuff, but I'm sure it's not going to take 740 years to wait for this to happen. Amen. That's a good thing. And Jesus was prophesied by God. In Genesis 3:15, God says that the son of the woman is going to step on the head of the serpent. So he talked about Jesus being born by a woman, Mary, and he was going to step over the head of Satan, which is represented in this place by the serpent. And so Jesus was waited for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. And finally, he came. And why is it so big, Christmas? Because Christmas has affected the life of millions and millions of people. And even people who are not Christians, their life is affected. You know that you live by the year 2020, and you live under a calendar that is started with the birth of Jesus. And if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and your Savior, when we accept Jesus, the same thing happened. There is a before Jesus and there is a after Jesus. This whole COVID thing is going to be done in a few months, in a year or two, but we are not going to celebrate. We're not going to celebrate in 2-3 years. The vaccine came out, or we don't have to wear the mask anymore, or this has changed. We are not going to, and this COVID thing has affected humanity. 99.9 probably of the human beings on this planet are being affected by this disease. But why is Christmas? If Jesus tarries to come and he comes in 1,000 or 2,000 years, let me tell you, Christmas is still going to be the biggest thing around. Why? Because Jesus changes the heart of a person. So why is Jesus so big? First, because who Jesus is, and Jesus is God. Jesus is God. Amen. And he left this heaven. He had made us. He left us here. We messed up with sin. And then he could have just abandoned us. He couldn't just destroy us. He couldn't just say, I'm going to make another person, another that is going to be better than this. But he leaves heaven to come to redeem us. And Jesus is pure love. I have not discovered pure love yet, honestly, in human relationships. Because Jesus is love. God is love. I'm going to tell you why. Because I do pre-marriage counseling, and sometimes I do marriage counseling. And I always ask this question. What this person, your spouse or spouse-to-be, has to do for you to leave them? I know a couple who he cheated on her 7 times, one after, and then again, and no, I'm not going to, and after 7 times, she finally left her. But I have not found one couple yet in the world, no matter how romantic and how much they love and how much amazingly they say they love, like nobody else love each other. But when I ask them a question, what did he or she has to do? There is always an answer. If he does this many times or does this, this is it. Love in relationships have always a condition. There is always an end if somebody mess up enough. But God, we can leave him, we can abandon him, we can walk away from him. And every time, how many times have you said to God, forgive me over the same sin you've done? The same, just one. And he's always waiting. His patience is always waiting for us. His mercy is bigger than any of your mistake, and his forgiveness is bigger than any of your sins. It's not like relationships in marriage. Like if you do this and do this again and do this again, well, definitely I know that you don't care about me and I'm done and I'm not going to forgive you again and I'm not going to stay in this relationship. And I understand all this thinking. What I'm talking about is the love of God and the patience of God and the mercy of God is so amazing. That's why Christmas is so amazing, because there is so many people who have not experienced love until they meet Jesus. And there is so many people who had experienced the love of God, the forgiveness of God, and they walk away and they come back. And God is always, waiting for us to forgive us, to embrace us, to restore us, to make us new again. The second reason why Christmas is so big, not just because who he is and how amazing he is and how loving and merciful and patient he is, but Christmas is so big also because of what he did for us. He left heaven to come and die for our sins. We are never going to understand that love. God had decided to love us so much that when we messed up, the worst of the worst as humans, he left heaven to die for our sins. You know what your biggest problem is? What your biggest problem is, what my biggest problem is in life, is not your spouse, is not your mother-in-law, is not the dog, is not the finances. The biggest problem that we have, thank you, Luis, is sin. Look what the Bible says. We just read it in Matthew 1:21. Here is talking about Mary. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. Can you look at the person next to you and tell them your biggest problem is sin? Nothing has hurt us more than sin. Our biggest problem is sin. I remember before I met Jesus, I was a slave. One of the areas there was a slave is with alcohol. I was an alcoholic. And I would just go and drink and drink and lose my mind and lose knowledge of what I was doing, where I was. And I would wake up hours later in the bad places, in places I would have never gone, in places that were so uncomfortable. And alcohol was destroying my life. And my dad would find me sometimes and bring me to the house. Or he was just open the door. I don't even remember coming into the house. And the next day, my dad will tell me, Christian, please, can you not drink so much? Look what alcohol is doing to you. And I honestly, many, many, many times, I would tell my dad, Dad, I promise you, very honestly, I'm never going to drink this much anymore. A little bit, yeah, but not this much. And the next weekend, I would go out again with the check of the whole week, the whole, and I would spend it all on alcohol until I would lose my head, my mind, knowledge of what I was doing and where I was. Why? Because I didn't have power to overcome this problem of sin in my life. And the biggest problem, we always say God came to save me from hell, and that is true, but the biggest problem we have in our lives is sin. And I know that you and I struggle with our minds and with our hearts more than we want to recognize it. Let's be honest. We all struggle with our hearts, with our emotions, with our feeling, with our anger, with our jealousy, with all these things that we have going inside of us. And a lot of times we don't want to tell people. And you and I have thoughts that we struggle that you're probably never going to want to tell people. But I am here to tell you that Jesus came to help us and to change the way we think and the way we feel. And that's the thing that a lot of times people say, I don't want to become a Christian because I don't understand these Christians who do this and don't do this. And the problem is not the problem is not the life with Jesus. The problem is the life without Jesus. The problem in our life is not having Jesus and He changing our way of thinking. Because I am glad I'm a Christian. You know why Christmas is so big? Because Jesus has changed and transformed the life of people. This is not a religion. This is not a way of thinking. This is just not good values. Or we all go to church because my dad took me to church. It's because Christmas is about Jesus, and He came to transform our way of thinking. If we surrender our lives to Him, I remember before I was a Christian, I had so many struggles in my mind, and I hated so many things that would go through my head, and I didn't know how to have victory over all these things, and I had no peace in my mind. I tell you honestly, I had no peace in my mind for the years that I was living this life of sin, unforgiveness, hate, immorality, things who thoughts, I was a slave of thoughts of my own mind that I hated, but they will keep coming. But one day I accepted Jesus into my life. And months later, something clicked. And I started thinking, wait a little bit. I haven't had those struggles in my mind for all this last, I don't know how many weeks or 2-3 months have been by. And I recognized that the moment I accepted Jesus and He came into my heart, He gave me victory and those most worst, horrible thoughts that I struggle. That's why Jesus and Christmas is so big. That's why your parents are going to do whatever to keep Christmas alive, to come to church, to buy gifts, to invite friends, to make a huge, huge, huge deal. I was driving by around my neighborhood last night, and it is beautiful to see how many houses have decorated and put up their lights. And I'm glad because I'm a Christian. I was comparing with a couple months ago, just maybe 1, 2, 3 houses in the whole neighborhood for Halloween. But for Christmas, a whole different deal. Because Jesus has changed so many people's life. The third reason why Christmas is so big, not just because who He is, or because what He did for us on the cross by saving us from our sins, but also for what He is preparing for us. John 14, verse 1 and 2 says, John 14, verse 1 and 2, here's Jesus talking. And He says, don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust also in Me. There is more than enough room in My Father's house. If there were not so, well, I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you. But I like this first verse. It says, don't let your hearts be troubled. You trust in God. Trust also in Jesus and what He did for us on the cross. This is the best words you might hear during this time of COVID. Anybody has had a heart trouble because of COVID? And the family, and jobs, and economy, and if I get it, and my grandma gets it, and I heard somebody who died, and I heard another who got sick, and I went another one to the hospital. But I want to tell you today, God is talking to you. If you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, God tells you, don't let your heart be troubled. It's a decision that we make to accept fear and anxiety in our minds, or make a decision to trust that God is going to take care of things. I want to ask you this morning, has God ever failed you? Anybody in this room who can say, God failed me. He messed me up. He abandoned me. He ruined my life. He left me alone to the wolves. Can anybody say God has failed me? Can you say people have failed me? Yeah. My plans have failed me. My ideas have failed me. Relationships have failed me. My best friends have failed me. Sin has failed me. Pleasure has failed me. But Jesus, He will never fail you. He loves you so much. He's not like people, not like friends, not like relationships, even romantic relationships, that if you do that for me, against me, I'll leave you. That's it. God is not like that. He's there always, 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 always. Jesus said that I am going to be faithful to you. I cannot deny who I am. And even if you are unfaithful, he remains faithfully loving you, waiting for you. That's why I like to make this comparison of how coronavirus is affecting this world. And this is not going to be remembered in 2 or 3 years. It's not going to be celebrated. Nobody's going to throw a party. Nobody's going to buy gifts. Nobody's going to make any celebration because coronavirus is gone. But Christmas is going to be always a huge deal because you came to know him. This says verse 2, there is a more than enough room, John 14:2, there is more than enough room in my Father's house. If this were not so, well, I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you. Jesus said, I told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if this would not be the truth, I wouldn't told you. It's not like us sometimes as parents say, I'm going to buy you something. We're going to go and do this. You tell your kids, you tell your spouse, and then things happen. And it doesn't happen. You forget. You don't have the money. You don't have the time. But Jesus says, I have told you enough. I would have never told you something that is a lie. Has God ever lied to you? Never failed you? Never not forgive you? Never not be there when you run to him? He's always, 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 always there. He says, I am going to prepare a place for you. So that where I am, the next verse says, you will also be. I remember it was one of the best illustrations I've ever seen in my life. Many years ago, Pastor Luis was preaching about eternity. And he brought a bucket. And he brought a bucket and put it here. And we didn't know what was in the bucket. And then he pulled the beginning of a string. And on the beginning of the string, he painted black, like this long. And he said, this, it was a white or yellow string. I think it was a white string. And he painted a different color, black or brown like that. He said, this much here of the string represents your 70 or 80 years of your life. And now let me show you what eternity is. And he started pulling the string out and pulling and pulling and pulling and pulling. And we were getting tired of looking at that string coming. This, he said, is the rest of your life, eternity. It never ends. Why will we not surrender our hearts to a God who loves us so much, who did everything for us to have an opportunity? He doesn't even force us. If I die for somebody, I would like to make sure that that death made a difference in that person. Wouldn't you? Wouldn't you? If you die for somebody, we'd like to make a difference. But Jesus says, I'll die for you, and if you accept me, well, it make the difference in your life. If you reject me, and everybody's going to walk out of this room this morning, and you're going to have made a decision in your life. You're going to accept the reason of Christmas, or you're going to reject the reason of Christmas. He says, I'm going to prepare a place for you. And I want to tell you a story of an eight-year-old boy. Eight-year-old boy is my story. When I was 8 years old, I heard the reality of heaven and of sin and of Jesus dying on the cross. And I was doing stuff. I was going to church. My father was a pastor, and I knew everything. But I had not surrendered my life to Jesus yet. So one night I had a dream. I'm telling you like it was last night. I remember it. I was running in this, like the movies, you know, running in this dirt road in the middle of the fields with my best friend. And there is a jeep, with like the enemy with a jeep, and the soldiers coming and shooting at us. And my friend got shot, and he died right there, and he just fell. And I kept running, and I rolled to the side of the road and hid it like in the ditch like that by bushes. And the jeep went by and didn't see me, and passed. And I woke up in that morning, and I was 8 years old. And I heard a voice, not in my room, nothing, not with my ears, but a voice in my heart and in my mind asking me, if you were to die today, would you go to heaven? The Holy Spirit was in that room. And God, who died for me, and he wanted me to have a new life with him, I feel like he made it special that night. And I knew that I hadn't surrendered my life to Jesus. I was doing whatever I wanted. I was just 8. I know the reality of heaven and of hell. See, Jesus is more than just an example. His example is amazing. But if he wouldn't die on the cross for you and me, his example wouldn't make much of a difference in our life. It's not about what we can learn from him. Yes, it is about that, but it's way more about what he did for us, who can change my life and my heart. And so I knew that I wasn't saved. I knew that I wasn't going to heaven with the life that I was living and just going to church, and that was all I was doing. So I walked through the living room, walked through the hallway, and went into my dad's and my mom's bedroom, and I woke up my dad in the middle of the night, and I said, Dad, I want to accept Jesus in my life. Because I had a dream that if I die tonight, I'm not going to heaven. And in that moment, I accepted Jesus in my heart. And I know that I know that I know that God started to do something. And this morning, I want you to close your eyes right there where you are. If you're 8 years old or 80 years old, we need to make a decision to accept the purpose of Christmas. Jesus came to save us from our sins. And the last part of verse 23 says, the virgin will conceive and give a birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. And I ask you this morning, is God with you? Is God in your life? Is God changing, guiding you, speaking to you, helping you with your struggle in your minds, in your hearts, in your struggle with sin? Is he with you? If he is not inside of you, Christmas and the purpose of Christmas has not done any difference in your life more than just eating meals every December and buying gifts. But Christmas is more than what we do culturally. Christmas is about God being inside of me. And if that's you this morning, and I want that, you want that Jesus in your life who can make all the difference, would you pray after me and say, God, I'm a sinner. I want you, God, to be in me, with me. Every second of my life, I want you in my life. I struggle, and I know it's because I don't have you. I need you in my life. Come and change the way I'm thinking, the way I'm acting. And I trust that your word says that you're preparing a place in heaven for those that follow you. God, we thank you for those who have done this prayer this morning. And I ask you that your Holy Spirit will come into their lives and change them and transform them. And they will experience the purpose of Christmas. God with us, who came to save us from our sins. Thank you, Jesus. You are huge. Nothing can be compared with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen and amen. God bless you. Have a great, great Sunday. On the left side here, we have a photo booth. We have cookies. We have music alive. Thank you for all those who are coming and volunteering all this morning, all the services in between to do ministry during and in between services. Thank you so much for helping us with the music, our life. God bless you. Have a wonderful, wonderful Christmas. God bless you.